Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome again. So this week we have Nermin and Samet as our presenters. They will present two very good papers that have been recently accepted to ECCV and BMEC. As far as I know, Nermin is going to present the two papers. Let me introduce Nermin. Nermin is one of our PhD students and a teaching assistant in our department. She received her bachelor degree from computer engineering from Hacettepe University and her master's degree in computer engineering from Bilkent University. And during her PhD, she's working with Emre Hoca on computer vision with problems related to object detection. So the scene is yours, Nermin. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much. Hi everyone. I will first start with our recent work published in ECCV called HAFNET. HAFNET is a new object detection method which takes into account both near and long range features. So in its most general form, we describe HAFNET as a one-stage, anchor-free, bottom-up and voting-based object detector. And here, voting is our main contribution, which integrates short and long-range visual evidence. So I will first start with our motivation. Current detectors rely on local features to detect an object. For example, to detect the mouse in this image, existing methods rely on local features that are on the mouse itself. But in HAFNET, detection of an object is also supported by faraway visual evidence. For example, the presence of the same mouse here is supported by the keyboard objects, and these keyboard objects are far away from the detected object mouse. And we achieve this through voting, and our method is inspired by the generalized half transform. And we use a log polar vote field where the location precision of votes decreases with distance. And here you see the overall processing pipeline of our method HAFNET, where the input image first passes through the backbone CNN. Then the output is fed to three separate branches. Our first branch is visual evidence prediction branch. It outputs visual evidence scores. And our voting module is attached to this branch. And the voting process here converts the visual evidence scores to the object presence maps. The second branch is with height prediction branch, and it outputs object spanning box dimensions. And our last branch is center offset prediction branch, which outputs object center offsets to recover the lost precision of center points due to these down sampling operations of the backbone CNN. And before describing the whole voting mechanism, I will first talk about our log polar vote field. We define the regions to collect the votes using log polar coordinate system. We call these regions as the vote field. And here you see an example vote field of HAFNET. And here the numbers on the vote field indicate the region IDs. And we parameterize a vote field by the number of angle bins, the number and the radii of eccentricity bins. For example, for this vote field, you see there are 13 regions, 6 angle bins, and 3 rings. And we implement this vote field as a non-learnable fixed weight transpose convolutional filter. Now I will talk about our voting module. So after the input image passed through the backbone network, the visual evidence branch, the visual evidence branch gets C tensors. Here C is the number of the classes, and each of these tensors has class conditional visual evidence scores. And the job of the voting module is here to produce these object presence maps for each class. And after the processing, after the voting process, the peaks in the object presence maps correspond or indicate the existence of objects. And to be more clear, now I will describe the voting process step by step. So this pick an arbitrary location and an arbitrary channel in visual evidence tensor. Here you see the location and the visual evidence. And we place our vote field centered at that location. And since we are using the third channel, we mark this relevant region shown with pink color on the visual evidence tensor. And we apply the voting and we show the results on the output tensor. To further illustrate the voting process, this time let's pick up another location and another channel on the visual evidence tensor. This time, the eighth channel in the visual evidence tensor. Again, we place our vote field centered at the location. And here we mark the target area to be voted on. And we again apply the voting. And we obtain this output, heat map output, since we take the precision depending on the distance to the center, we obtain this heat map. And before our updation and experiments, I want to talk about our mini train COCO set. So for faster experimental analysis, we created a mini training set for COCO. So we call this new set as MiniTrain, and while sampling the MiniTrain from the full train set of COCO, we preserve three quantities as much as possible. So the first one is proportion of object instances from each class. And the second one is overall ratios of small, medium, and large objects. And the last one is per class ratios of small, medium, and large objects. And for validation, we trained six different object detectors on COCO mini train set, and we computed the linear correlation using Pearson correlation coefficient. And the results we obtained show that there is a strong positive correlation between the mini train performance and full COCO performances. Now I will talk about our ablation experiments. So our first set of ablation experiments done for the world field, and we did these experiments on COCO mini train and tested them on world set. And here you see the experiments on angle beams, and we started with a very large 65 by 65 world field with 5 rings. We experimented with several degree beams. And our experiments depend based on our experiments, 9 degree yields the best performance for both AP and AP50. And that's why we use this setting in the rest of our experiments. And we also conducted experiments to analyze the importance of walls. So our first case is only center case. In this case, we only keep the center ring and disable the rest. This way, we only aggregate walls from object center. And this case corresponds to a traditional object detection paradigm where only local evidence is used. And this experiment shows that walls from outer rings help to improve the performance. And our second case is no center case. And this time, we only disable the center ring. And we observed that there's only 0.3 degrees in AP. And this experiment shows that the evidence for detection is embedded mostly around the object center, not directly inside the center. And we did only context experiment also to observe the power of long-range walls. For this experiment, we used only the three outer rings, and we observed that the AP decreased by 1.2 AP. And in order to determine how far an object should get lost from, we experimented with ring counts also. So we discarded the outer ring layers one by one, as you see here. And the model with three rings yields the best performance on AP metric, and it was also the fastest one. And our model with 5 rings has the best AP50 results. Our second set of ablation experiments done for the comparison between dilated convolutions and our voting module. The dilated convolutions, which can also include long-range features, could be considered as an alternative to our voting module. And that's why we did ablation experiments to compare our voting module and dilated convolution. And we compare our voting module to an equivalent dilated convolution filter on COCO set. And our voting module outperforms dilated convolution results for all AP metric. And comparison with baseline and SOTA. So HalfNet improves its strong baseline center net up to 2.2% AP, depending on the backbone. And our best model performs on par with the state of the art. And here we provide some visualization of walls for sample detections from HalfNet. And you see sample detections of HalfNet and their word maps. Colors indicate word strength based on the standard JET color map. And in these mouse object examples, in addition to local words, we observe strong words coming from the nearby keyboard objects. Another similar behavior is observed in the detections of baseball glove and tennis racket. And this time, these objects get strong walls from ball, and the ball objects are far away from these detected objects. And another interesting result, where dining table gets strong walls from the candle objects. To note, candle is not among COCO classes. And we think that another task our voting module helps improve is the task of image generation from a given label map, where long range interactions is important. And for this purpose, we take CycleGAN and Pix2Pix as our baselines for unpaired and paired training, respectively. And we attach our voting at the end of the CycleGAN and Pix2Pix models and experiment with the popular labels to photo task on Cityscape's dataset. And here we show the visual results for these experiments. And as you see, when our voting module is attached, the generated images conforms to the given input segmentation maps better. And also in Pix2Pix, our voting module helps to generate more detailed images. And that's all for HalfNet. You can get our HalfNet code and the mini train set from our repos. And if you have any question, I'm here.
Any questions for the first part? Thank you, Nermin. I already know the details, so I'm from your thesis. Are you planning to extend this by making the field learnable?
Actually, there is a learning process, implicit learning process for the word field. I did an experiment to make this word field to be learnable. It didn't help much. That's why we leave it here. And now we are extending this work to temporal voting for video object detection. And our temporal voting module helped to improve this video object detection a lot, significantly.
I guess there are no other questions.
I can ask one question, actually. Nermin, is there a reason to use ring-based bins for the voting instead of rectangular bins?
Yes, the one reason we are inspired from these biological methods where these foveated systems are very popular and they use also this similar to log polar word field. The second reason is that we can get equal bins, equal area bins when we using the log polar word field. When we go with these rectangle bins, then it is very hard to get these equal area bins.
Yes, makes sense. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I guess there are no other questions. Maybe we can come to the second part.
Okay, now I will stop sharing and I will reshare the other slides. Did you see my screen? No?
Yep.
Okay. So now I will present our second work called Reducing Label Noise in Non-Corfury Object Detection. And in this study, we propose a prediction pooling detector as a non-corfury object detection method to relax the positive labeling strategy and so that the model is able to reduce the contributions of non-discriminatory features during training. And in this work, our main contribution is prediction pooling, and we use this prediction pooling both during training and inference. And I will start again with our motivation. So current non-corfury detectors label all the features in a predefined area of a ground truth box as positive. And but the features within a ground truth box may come from the background, occluders, or non-discriminative part of the objects. So for example, here the laptop object is occluded by the cat at its center. And in our method, class predictions from the positive area of a ground truth box get pulled together and they contribute to the loss as a single prediction. And this allows the model to reduce the contributions of non-discriminative features during the training. And at inference, highly overlapping boxes are again pulled together and we obtain the final detections. For example, here, the colored dots show the locations whose predictions are pulled to generate the final detection. And here, highest contributions are coming from the objects itself, not occluders or background areas. And again, here is the our pipeline, training pipeline. And the input image first passes through a backbone CNN. It's followed by a feature pyramid network. Then the output is fed through two separate branches. Our first branch is classification branch, as shown here, and it outputs width by height by C tensors. Here, C is the number of the classes. And blue and red cells represent foreground cells, and the empty ones are background cells. The blue cells are assigned to the Fritzbo object, and the red cells assigned to the person object. To obtain the final detection score for an object instance, we aggregate the classification scores of all the cells by adding them together to obtain a final vector. And our second branch is the regression branch. It outputs object bounding box coordinates. And here, note that each foreground cell is trained to predict its own assigned object ground truth box. And at inference, we first produce the initial detections from input image, and then we associate each detection with a bounding box, object class, and confidence score. Then we eliminate detections labeled as background class. Next, remaining detections are pulled together. So if two detections belonging to the same object class overlap more than a certain amount, we consider them as voting for the same object. And we apply this process to every pair of detections and obtain scores for final detections. And as a last step, we apply class-aware non-maximum suppression. And now experiments. Our first set of ablation experiments done for the size of the positive area. And we did these experiments on Coco train and tested them on Valset. And we adjust the size of positive area for pooling by multiplying its width and height with a shrink factor. And we experimented with shearing factors between 1 and 0.2. And according to our experiments, shearing factor 0.4 yields the best performance. That's why we use this setting in the rest of our experiments. And to find the optimal balance between classification and regression loss, we did ablation experiments on the regression loss weight. And based on these experiments, we set the weight of the regression loss to 0.75 and for the rest of our experiments. Our method samples predictions into a single prediction for each object. And this reduced the number of positive during training. And you can think that it worsens the class imbalance problem even more. So we calculate the average number of the positives per per image. And it is 7 for our method, 41 for fovea box, it is one of our baselines, and it is 165 for RetinaNet, another popular object detection method. And when looking at this number, we see that our method considerably decreases the number of the positives, but this number is still very small compared to the number of the negatives. That's why our method does not worsen the existing class imbalance problem more. And to tackle the class imbalance problem, we use focal loss. And comparison with SOTA, our best model performs on par with the state of the art, and our method outperforms all major one stage and two stage methods in small object detection. We did another experiment series to analyze the effect of our prediction pooling for training and inference separately. So when we remove the prediction pooling from the inference pipeline of our model, we observe that the AP goes down by 2.5 points on one set. And to analyze the effect of the prediction pooling for training, we added the prediction pooling to RetinaNet and fovea box only during inference. So there is no prediction pooling in training. And this resulted in 0.5 and 2.8 AP drop for RetinaNet and fovea box respectively. And we also compared our sum pooling with max pooling. And for max pooling, we identified the feature within the positive area whose predicted box overlaps the most with the ground truth box. Then we use only this feature in the focal loss to represent its ground truth box during training. And this approach dropped AP by more than 2 points. And we also did some visual inspection, and here we show the heat map of cell centers relative to the ground truth box, and they are responsible for detection. And here all ground truth boxes in dataset are normalized to any unit box as shown with blue color. And RetinaNet detects objects mostly with center cells. And in terms of pickiness, fovea box heat maps are very similar to RetinaNet's. But when we look at PPDET, it detects objects from a wider area, even also from outside of the object box. And these heat maps verifies our method's dynamic characteristics on assigning weights to the features in the positive area during training. And that's all for PPDET, and our code is available at this GitHub page. Thank you.
Thank you, Nermin, Samet, for these nice works and for the nice presentation. Any questions from the audience? Everything was cleared for everyone. Maybe I can ask one. So, do you think did you try learned pooling for instead of sum pooling or max pooling, where you could have the weights and the weights could be learned by the network?
No, we didn't try it. It also suggested by reviewers, but okay. No, we didn't try it.
Okay. I'm not that reviewer, so to clarify. So this is for the bicycle. You don't see the activations localized on the object. You see, I mean, this is still a Gaussian shape, right?
Yes.
I think the problem is the receptive fields are not very localized at that level. So a certain neuron is receiving information from actually a big region, and that's why we don't see strong localization on the boundary or on the shape of the object.
Yes. We, looking at this visual inspection, we see that only PPDET has more, PPDET uses more feature to detect an object instead of using a single sensor location.
Mm-hmm.
It just uses more.
Mm-hmm. That's really interesting. Nice.
Yeah. We think that's why it's also very effective for small objects, because sometimes it's not enough to use just one feature at the center to detect an object, so the others could help.
Yeah, true. And for small objects, you are increasing the range.
Yes.
Sounds good. Anyone else? Maybe we can stop the recording and switch to a more informal session. Thank you, Nermin, again, and Samet.
Thank you very much.
Presentation. We will continue in Turkish.